This is Berkeley Square in London's West End. And the reason I'm here is because I've been given access to a unique piece of fishing history. This is Maggs Brothers, who sell antiquarian books and manuscripts, and they've been here for over 160 years. And the man I've come to see is Jonathan Riley, who's going to tell me all about this literary treasure. That looks very interesting, but what exactly am I looking at?
You are looking at a mid-15th century prayer book that belonged to a monk from Admont Abbey in Austria. He was a priest in the monastery, it was a Benedictine monastery, and this was his daily book for the summer months. But as with all books of this, or manuscripts of this sort of antiquity, we like to take a closer look and see if there are any signs of who owned it and what else might be going on. So towards the back of the manuscript, we notice that after the end of the breviary, we have a little group here of handwritten pages.
I can see, yes.
Which are start off with a page here in Latin, but then suddenly switch to a Germanic vernacular text, which is really quite difficult to read, even if you are, you know, present-day German speaker. It's in Middle High German and possibly an Austrian dialect, which makes it even more remote. So we realised it needed further investigation.
You were intrigued?
Very much intrigued, yeah.
And the results of your investigations, you obviously got an expert to look at it.
Yeah.
And you were very surprised, weren't you?
We were. I mean, the things that we could work out in-house were that they were talking about various colours and feathers. And our first thoughts were that it might be some sort of alchemical recipe, which would be slightly odd at the back of a priest's prayer book. But that seemed the most likely thing. But with a bit more work and asking a few experts' opinions, everything drew us towards fishing.
Right. And it does?
Yes, the first page here has a group of recipes for artificial fly patterns.
Really? Just to put this into context, this monk has his daily prayer book. He's on his own one day and he's got some spare pages.
Yep.
And he writes down some, you say recipes, but some patterns we would call, for
right.
Some flies which he can catch fish with.
Absolutely. And it's quite astounding. And he goes into great detail as to which feathers should be used, how they should be put together. And we were intrigued. And at this period, from what we've learnt, it was very unusual for these to be actually written down. They would normally have been passed on, so these patterns in an oral tradition from fisherman to fisherman. And here we have what we feel is the first time that somebody has written them down on paper.
We're talking about 1450,
1450s, yeah.
So is it just fly patterns?
Well, no. We start off with the fly patterns, which are on this page and beginning of the next page. And then we go on to quite detailed bait recipes, which are quite extraordinary concoctions of things. And then the final section on this page and the last page are on various traps and nets and other ways of catching fish. It's interesting that he moves from one separate set of descriptions to another. So there seem to be three varieties in his mind, okay. You know, artificial flies, baits, and then other methods.
The bait recipes, does it mention anything specific?
A number of things. Everything from flying worms, bits of ox meat, chopped egg, ants' eggs, all sorts of unusual concoctions. And it also mentions their use in catching grayling and trout. There's a reference at the front, which is a further addition in the same handwriting, so again from the same period, which does mention, it mentions a carp, and we're pretty sure it's a crucian carp.
Really?
And that's just in this section here.
This is amazing. You know, carp fishing is such a really big deal these days, but in those days, I mean, carp were the table fish, weren't they? All over Europe. And this is amazing. And crucian carp. Well, crucians, I know you're not a fisherman.
I'm afraid right? not.
Well, you know, people these days have got these whopping great big, right. You know, whopping great big fish. But crucian carp, they only grow to about 4 or 5 pounds. I think the record is about 5.5 pounds.
Gosh.
So they're small, probably easily cultivated fish.
Yeah.
And, you know, I sort of imagine this guy looking out the window, and there's the pond. And when he mentions feathers and stuff like that, you can imagine that they've got wildfowl, haven't they? Got geese.
Yes, absolutely.
And perhaps he sat there one afternoon watching a feather float across, and all of a sudden a fish has come and had a little pop at it. Or he's thought, well, I'm bored with just netting them, you know. Let's have a go. It's intriguing. What was going on in the guy's mind?
It is intriguing, and we don't know. And that's why something like this provides us with evidence, a bit more evidence, so that more work can be done on whether this particular priest was writing these down for his own pastime of fishing as recreational fishing, or whether it was to do with the wider thing of the monastery having to fish to feed its monks. And we don't know the answer to that yet, but perhaps this will help us along that that line.
You mentioned earlier on, you know, they're using a rod and they've got 2 or 3 flies on it. Now, my instinct tells me that if you were just providing food for the table, and you've got a river there and a pond, and you've got nets and that apparatus.
You just do the nets, yes.
There's easier ways than fly fishing. So there has to be some sort of, can I put it, sporting element to this. He's intrigued by it.
Yeah.
Absolutely amazing. And to a certain extent, your historians are trying to get into this gentleman's mind, aren't they?
Yes, that's what we want. We want it to be studied further so we can actually answer some of these questions, because if it was a pastime for these monks, that's quite extraordinary. It perhaps takes back fishing as a pastime a little bit further than we thought.
Well, at least
recorded
fishing.
Exactly,
I think people have been fishing ever since God was a boy, personally. Now, having sort of spoilt many books in my lifetime by writing my own notes on them, how can you be sure that these notes are contemporaneous to the original document?
No, you're absolutely right. The reason we can is that the leaves that they're on are integral to the rest of the book. They haven't been slipped in later at any later time. Also, the handwriting, one can see, is even though one part is in Latin, the other part in Middle High German, the handwriting is definitely of the same era, if not by the very same hand. And we are presuming it is by the same hand. And also the Latin section here, we know as it talks of Pope Pius II, we know that his reign was 1458 to 1464. So it's relevant that it would have been written in that period while he was still alive. And then the final section here, which discusses things that are going on in the monastery in Latin, is actually dated 1452, but this may have been written a couple of years later. So we think by saying around 1460, we're not over sort of egging it, and it fits in perfectly with the rest of the manuscript, which we already feel is certainly around 1450, regardless of the manuscript editions.
This is very early, isn't it, for somebody describing
Absolutely.
Fly patterns?
It's very early, and what we had to try and work out is whether it was the earliest. And luckily, there's been quite a lot of work done on a manuscript from another Benedictine monastery in Germany called Tegernsee. And this is very well documented as being written at about 1500. And that is generally thought to be the first written collection of patterns. But this is definitely 30 years plus older than that manuscript. And so we now feel, as do experts we've talked to, that this is the earliest known collection of written patterns for artificial flies.
So I'm going fly fishing in a few days' time, having just seen in the centre of London a book which contains the earliest records of some fly patterns in history.
Yes.
Now, are you able to interpret the flies, the colours of the flies? Because basically, it's interesting. He might have some good ones there.
Well, we're still doing a lot of work on this because the translation is proving to be quite tricky. But a rudimentary translation talks about lots of different coloured feathers coming from the breast feathers of various birds. It talks of silver, red, black feathers being used. We think there would have been multiple lines off a single rod. And I think what's wonderful about it is it does need a lot more work.
So how did you actually come by this book?
Well, we're sort of buying and selling books all the time. We buy from collectors, dealers, auctions. This particular manuscript came from a colleague in the US. We bought it primarily because we didn't know about the fishing material at the back as a monastic breviary from the 15th century, which is the sort of thing we try and buy whenever we can.
Now, what's going to happen to this book now?
Well, we're antiquarian booksellers here in London, and we're offering it for sale, and we're publicising it at the moment.
So, if it's not impertinent, how much are we looking at?
Well, it's been a very, very difficult thing to value because it being the earliest of something is always takes you into another realm financially. One of the ways of gauging it is that copies of Isaac Walton's Complete Angler are now selling for around £75,000. But we've come to a figure of £125,000. And the thing about Isaac Walton, however important it is, there are a number of copies. The thing about this manuscript is that it's unique.
The only one.
Yes.
Wow.